Hello everyone and welcome to this session on digital PCR. We're going to just give a cycling run through of it and then compare it to traditional PCR, qPCR and then this digital PCR, which is considered third generation PCR. Let's get into it.
Researchers performing sensitive applications such as copy number variation and rare target detection often find themselves struggling to identify faint genetic signals against a strong background, especially when it is a single positive lost in a dense pool of negatives. Finding the rare allele or mutant sequence is a typical needle in a haystack problem. By partitioning the sample into a large number of individual reactions, digital PCR makes it surprisingly easy to detect the single positive. And it's precisely in these instances where the lower limit of detection doesn't allow traditional qPCR, real-time PCR, to be a viable solution. And so today's complex research questions demand a depth of information that's beyond the capacity of traditional PCR technologies. Third generation digital PCR is reducing that gap and becoming a much simpler and more practical technique to address. So digital PCR can be referred to as third generation PCR. The concept of digital PCR has been around since 1992 when Sykes et al. Described it as a limiting dilution PCR. This general method used endpoint analysis and Poisson statistics to quantify the absolute number of nucleic acid molecules present in a sample. What followed was a revolutionary work by Bogenstein and Kinsler in 1999, and they developed a method where the sample was diluted and distributed into individual reactions called partitions. And single products with fluorescent signals were detected and analyzed after amplification. They coined the term digital PCR, as we all know it today. Over the years, the methods have been innovated and commercialized for wider adoption. For instance, one can perform digital PCR on microfluidic chips and discs, microarrays, microdroplets, or droplet crystals based on oil-water emulsions, and more recently in qPCR-like plates. Digital PCR is a highly precise approach to sensitive and reproducible nucleic acid detection and quantification. The measurements are performed by dividing the sample into partitions, such that there are either zero or one or more target molecules present in any individual reaction. Each partition is analyzed after endpoint PCR cycling for the presence or absence of a fluorescent signal, and the absolute number of molecules present in the sample is calculated. It does not rely on a standard curve for sample target quantification, and so it eliminates the reliance on standard curves. So in this way, the sample is pretty much prepared like you would for qPCR, and then the sample partitioning is divided into thousands of individual reactions where amplification is unique to digital PCR. So by random distribution of molecules into partitions, unlike the bulk analysis in qPCR, digital PCR minimizes the effects of competing targets, and it enhances the precision and sensitivity power of detection, and particularly of detection of those events that are rare. So in this way, it allows researchers to quantify low abundance targets or targets in complex backgrounds. It detects and discriminates allelic variants, and it can monitor small fold changes in target levels that are otherwise undetectable by qPCR. So here's the kicker, right? So contrary to real-time qPCR, digital PCR does not rely on every amplification cycle to determine the relative amount of target molecule. Instead, it relies on Poisson statistics to determine the absolute target quantity following an endpoint amplification. Poisson statistics, what is that? It turns out that Poisson statistics allows the number of positive and negative reactions to be measured precisely. as the target molecule is distributed randomly across all available partitions. Poisson distribution estimates the average number of molecules per partition, 0, 1 or more, and calculates the copies of the target molecule per positive partition. And apparently, this means that the number of positive and negative reactions that you calculate are precise. So in the context of a digital PCR experiment, absolute quantification relies on the random distribution of target molecules across the partitions, and the data is expected to fit a Poisson distribution. Poisson distribution got its name in 1837 after the French mathematician Simeon Denis Poisson, and it's applied to the probability of a given number of events in a fixed period if the events occur at a known constant rate and are independent of the occurrence of the previous events. Yeah. Let's touch you on that a little bit. So giving this example from the Kaijin website, you end up having, say if you had 8,000 valid events, but you detected only 4,000 of that as positive, you pop it into this equation, and so you end up being able to calculate the exact number of copies that you had without the use of a standard to compare it to. And so the advantage of this is that you can have detection of rare transcripts. Researchers can quantify low abundance targets or targets in complex backgrounds. You can detect and discriminate allelic variants and monitor small fold changes and target levels that are undetectable in qPCR. The specific advantages of partitioning is that you effectively increase the concentration, your limit of detection in each little partition. And so you have this enrichment effect that's occurring, and that increases your ratio of target over the background. And so you have this opportunity now where you have needle in a haystack situations of detecting that rare event. You know what they say about what happens when you assume something? Yeah, you make an ass out of you and me. So let's not do that, and let's just make sure we are on the same page with PCR, since we're calling this third generation. What did the other generations look like? So let's pretend we're reading Arabic, and we're going to start from the right and work our way forward. The traditional PCR, you just measure the amount of accumulated PCR at the end of each cycle. With real-time PCR, you're measuring the PCR amplification as it occurs. With digital PCR, we are measuring the fraction of the negative microreactions to determine the absolute copies. So is it quantitative? No, not when you're doing traditional basic PCR. Even though when you're comparing the intensity of the amplified band on a gel to standards of a known concentration, this will give you a semi-quantitative result, but it's not really quantitative. With qPCR, yes, because the data is collected during the exponential growth or the log phase. And so when the quantity of the PCR product is directly related to the standard, you get proportional amounts of template nucleic acid. With digital PCR, again, yes, because the fraction of the negative microreactions is fit to a Poisson statistical algorithm. So then what are the unique applications? With traditional or standard PCR, you can basically obtain DNA for your sequencing reactions, for genotyping, or for cloning. With qPCR, you can use it for quantitating gene expression, for microarray verification, for quality control and assay validation, pathogen detection, SNP detection, and if we go on to the next slide and continue with qPCR, you can look at copy number variation, microRNA analysis, viral quantitation, and siRNA, RNA interference experiments. With digital PCR, the strength for its application is the absolute quantification of viral load, absolute quantification of nucleic acid standards, absolute quantification of next generation sequencing libraries and rare allele detection, as well as absolute quantification of gene expression. So that brings us to the end of this video looking at digital PCR, qPCR, and traditional PCRs. I hope it was useful, and I'll catch you in the next one. God bless you. Bye.